Clément takes my head in his hands, leans his damp forehead against mine. Our lips meet. Our embrace is full of passion and despair. He goes back to his table. Mozart soon gives way to personal messages, curiously in tune with the tragic and heroic message of the symphony they interrupt. A friend is coming tonight is the second message we are waiting for after the omelette flambée. The friend should have come by now. He hasn't. The speaker announces, end of personal messages. Clément turns off the radio. He says, I am beginning to think that Gérard was right. Our elusive friend is obviously too busy or just bloody-minded. This is terrible, I say, feeling utterly outraged by this letdown. I ask, does London know about this? They do. I spend my time telling them that if they want us to stop the enemy's armoured cars fleeing northward, they've to send us proper ammunition for the operation. Twice they cut us off. Probably fed up with my repetitive messages. I asked myself then, as I asked myself in retrospect, was it because we were accepting young communists who felt ill at ease in a maquis mainly oriented towards the Catholic Rite? Surely London and Le Général must have known about them and might have felt reluctant to arm young fanatics, disciples of Jean-Paul Sartre's new perception of La Liberté, who might cause trouble after the war, if not during. I remember how Clément and Gérard feared for the future of their recruits and how they were proven right. Indeed, many of those named fanatics would die in the last hours of the war, either in combat or in concentration camps, for a freedom they didn't live long enough to experience or enjoy.